We're going to go through some questions now. I'm going to start off the questions. After that, you guys can just raise your hand and ask anything to any of these guys. But and then for the panel up here, Jason, we're just going to, everybody's going to answer this question I'm going to tell you. So just when Jason, you're done, you're to pass it down, just speak into the mic, make sure it's on to you. Yeah, it's on. Okay, perfect. So here's the question. Is a lead a lead a lead? Are all leads the same? Jason.
All leads are definitely not the same. A lead, though, when you really simmer it down, all has the same context that you need to not view a lead as a sale. You need to be viewing a lead as nothing less and nothing more than an opportunity to bring value to a consumer and to have a good conversation. It is not for the purpose of a sale. The sale can happen as a byproduct, but it's all about conversations. So yes, is a lead a lead a lead? No, there's garbage leads, there's good leads, but if you have a human being that picks up, that is now an opportunity to have a conversation, capitalize on it, go from there, bring value.
Ditto.
Good answer.
It's, to me, it's the opportunity to talk to somebody, opportunity to have a conversation. You never know what's going to come of it, but I've only really worked one type of lead. So,
I think leads a lead. There's bad leads. There's all different. I've worked Facebook leads. I've worked, of course, mail drop leads. I think Jason really answered it best. But it gives you an opportunity to call somebody, just, you know, to be able to do your job. Just make sure you're calling them. Even if you think it's bad, make sure you're calling them.
Well, you don't even have an idea if it's bad till you call them.
Right. Well,
you guys work too hard. A lead is my slave. I choose the people that I want to talk to. I choose the time when I want to talk to them. I talk to people between the ages of 65 and 83. And the reason I talk to people between the ages is, and they own a house. 65, 83 own a house. That's a lead to me, okay? What do I need out of a lead? I need an appointment. So I don't look at a lead, I look at an appointment. I call in order to generate the business that I do, and these folks that buy leads, well, you know, you heard 90 to 100. I go through 400 leads, 2 cents a piece, bits of information a day in order to generate what I do. That's a telemarketer on a state-of-the-art live line dialer out of New Hampshire. That line dialer doesn't have a pause to it. So if the person picks up the phone, it costs me a lot more money to have a live line dialer, but if the person picks up the phone, there's not a delay that I know when I get one in my phone, I hang up on, because there's a delay, okay? I do a live line dialer out of New Hampshire. It's called Mojo. In Mojo, I put the data out of InfoFree.com. InfoFree.com, I select the data that I'm looking for. I'm looking for homeowners in a zip code. I work in an area. I book my leads tight. I have a 10:15, 11:15, 12:15, 1:15. And I'm not kidding. The dog and I are on the beach by 3 o'clock. The lead is my servant in order for me to do my job. It's very difficult to duplicate that. Wouldn't you agree, David? It is a bugger to get people to do that. But if you can own your own ability to control your day, that to me is freedom, you know? And I can turn it off. If somebody calls me and says, hey, can you run up to Nashville, Tennessee? I called my telemarketer and I said, hey, guess what? You got 2 paid vacation days. I'm not working. I'm going to go help my friend up in Nashville, and I'm going to go meet some new friends, and maybe something else will happen. I don't know, but that's what a lead is to me.
Questions from the audience. Yeah. James.
I got 3. So I'm going to start here. Telesales.
Sure.
On the telesales side, earlier you mentioned your rebuttal technology. Can you expound on that?
Absolutely. So in my agency, we've got proprietary systems where we do rebuttaling technology and techniques that are turnkey. So it's not your traditional like boxing match that you find in a lot of other agencies. Okay, so my agency is very unique that way. We use different scriptings, we use different techniques to handle our consumer in the best professional way possible, as opposed to what's being done in the industry, which is kind of like push-pull all the time. So yeah, definitely can reach out, jasonfinalexpense.com. Definitely can help you go over some of that, but it's nothing that we can accomplish in a 45-minute session. Let's just put it that way. We do all-day telemastery training, so we can't really compress all of that in such a short period of time.
Massive amount for the lead cost, especially for an agency owner, that, you know, that's a big scary thing, if that makes sense.
Oh, yeah.
And so, I guess can you walk us through how you went from slowly ramped up your leads, why you did it, and that type of thing? Because I think for some new agents, that's, you know, that's a big deal as well.
Sure. I started with the 360 free leads, or they call them free leads, but I mean, you got to kind of get rolling. Right. And then once you get that rolling, they become, some of them become free. I mean, Dave can probably explain most of that, how that happens. But I started with about 40 leads, you know, kept the cash flow going, and then I bumped it to 50, and I bumped it all the way up to 75. And then I started buying, actually, I take that back. What? This is confusing, I apologize. Actually, I started with Need a Lead first. I started buying leads through Need a Lead first, and then Dave got me hooked up with 360 Financial. He said, why aren't you using these leads? And got that all worked out. But I was buying, I was roughly spending about $1,200 to $1,500 a week, and then I've slowly kind of built that up to where I'm investing majority of what I'm making into the leads for the back end side, really. I mean, I squeeze pretty much everything I can out of my income into my leads, basically, and I, you know, yeah, just for the back side. So I'm, when I say I'm working 100 leads that week, I mean, it's probably about 75 from the 360 and a 25 drop from like Need a Lead or Lead Concepts or something, but always mail drop leads. But I mean, when I first started, I mean, finding Dave was one of the biggest things that got my business going. I had to sell a rifle, a couple pistols, because I was flat broke. And I sold that, rolled it into leads, and then I sold Final Expense on that amount, and I rolled all that back into leads, and I just kept rolling it to where now I don't really worry about my income. Everything's on automatic. I've got enough income coming in every week now to where I know my lead budget's about, it's a little under $2,000 a week if the free leads don't come in like I need them to. So you got to start small, of course, and just kind of build it up. I mean, that's kind of the way I did it. And I put my family through hell doing it because we were broke for a long time. But everything was going back into the business, so especially for Medicare.
Okay. And last one for Steve. Yes. You mentioned earlier when you, you know, you showed the example and you put 100% into that 105% participation bucket, and then you said that, you know, but you wouldn't really do that now. Can you expound on that a little bit?
Yes.
I got an idea, but,
it's a good question. So the best way to do it, the proper way to do it, and there's a proper way to do it. And if you go on the Athene website and you look up allocation strategies, the proper way to do an allocation strategy, and it's for the best interest of the client, is to put them in a one-year point-to-point BNPP. Mm-hmm. And then a two-year point-to-point on the other half. So half of it's on a one-year, half of it's on the two-year. Mm-hmm. At the end of the first year, you go back you revisit the client, and you put that 1 year, which is a 70% participation rate, into the 2 year point-to-point, which kicks it back up to 105. Now it's indexing every year, steady growth, and the reason I do that for every single client I have is I got tired of people calling me up after the first year and saying, where's my money?
Right.
If you have a nice even allocation where they're getting money every time, they never make the phone call. I'm a lazy guy. I don't want people to be upset. And it's the proper way to do it. So does it take a little bit more effort? Yes. Does it take a little bit more explanation? Yes. Is it worth it for me? Absolutely. It's worth
no,
it for
the... No surrender charges on that one year point to point?
I'm not sure. The surrender charge happens if you pull out more than...
Right, but you said you roll them in from the 1 year to the 2 year.
Oh, yeah, there's no. At the end of the 1 year, you get a choice of a different index. So if it indexes at the end of 1 year, you can choose to go into different indexes. What I have them do is I explain to them, this is what we're doing. This is why we're doing it. I leave them with the page that comes from Athene on an explanation on how to do it. I leave the paperwork with them in case I don't get around to doing that. But at the end of the year, I go through all my clients. Every month I get an alert, and if I see it's coming up, I call them up and I say, hey, just to remind you, you're gonna get paperwork, kick it over to the 2 year point to point. And if you want me to, I can come back and help you with that. But I really don't, I try to set it up on the delivery of the policy that it automatically kicks in. It's for the best interest of the client, and it makes my life easy.
Next question. Jason, I think, is out of here in about 10, 15 minutes. So if you got a question for Jason, you're in front of the line. Okay, here I come.
Okay. Good? A little lower. Okay. Okay. Hello? That's right there. Perfect, right?
Yeah, you just messed with
me. Man. Okay, Jason, my mental game. So I used to be in a call center where they fed me leads. I'm out. Buying leads, initiating the calls. I did not fill out the form. That was 3 months ago, or I already bought. And I've read scripts and I've gotten some training on how to overcome those things and get into the pitch. However, I still cringe and therefore I have no confidence calling. I stopped calling. Now I have what were 3 months leads, 3 month old leads. Now they're a year old because, I just left them there. Any advice?
Absolutely. So a lot of the times when we have that little fear that takes place, it really comes down to just having that training and technique being invested in you. So if you had more time and training in the technique of how to handle and overcome that, it wouldn't be scary at all. Right? That's all it is. So it's like, this is where in my telemastery programs, I spend a lot of time going over this and really training agents to the point of proficiency before they touch a lead. I've got agencies that have come from a lot of other agencies and joined, touched three-month-old leads, year-old leads, and found tremendous success. Right. And that's where my training is proprietary. It's crazy good at what it is. And that's why it's really well-oiled, because it's turnkey, it's a machine. You don't have to overthink. And all those rebuttals that you're speaking of, I've already got printed out, it's done. All you have to do is just follow the systems. If you would just follow it, right? Just like the plays from a football game, follow the play. Just follow the play, right? If you follow it, it's like, no big deal. You won't have this delay in you. And that's where you just have to practice, drill, and rehearse from good technique, good proprietary training, implement, and you'll be solid. It has nothing to do with your leads or you, because you've done it before. It's just that, is it that discomfort that takes place?
I retract and I don't want to call people. And I keep with the call center sending me calls. I can pitch and I can sell, but this is the first thing that I have to overcome now that I'm buying my own leads and outbound.
Absolutely, because it is scary. You put out that money for leads, you've got to be able to overcome that with confidence, and then you've got that pep in your step when you handle that lead. So you're going to have more closes, more capitalization to help them meet that, and that's where really training and that time that you'll put in will help you shine.
Okay.
So, no, and I appreciate that. And thank you, David, for bringing my agency here.
First of all, thank you guys for sharing your knowledge. It's helped me a ton, so thank each and every one of you guys. So in the telesales space, Jason, and then all of you guys, could you talk a little bit about just self-genning leads, Steve. It sounds like you self-gen. Obviously, you do. Just talk to me about the amounts, the costs, maybe a little bit of the how, maybe just briefly.
Sure. So I'll go over that. I'm going to tell you right now, my closing ratio has always been to the point that I don't self-generate leads, okay? If the dog hunts, I'll tell you the dog hunts. I don't generate my own leads. I have people that I partner with that are much smarter than me, okay? I've got great folks that I partner with that help you generate your own leads. I'm not that man. Know where to stay in your lane, know where your strengths are, do a lot more of that, and then leverage out. If someone else is good at making leads, Godspeed. Let them do that. And that's where I'm gonna use my weaknesses in that area, which is, that is my weakness. I've never generated my own leads, not planning on it either. I got no problem buying a lead and just handling that need for me. But a new agent, capitalization is important. So it's valuable that you learn how to do those leads. If you need help, reach out. I can help you get in touch with good people, David can as well, to do that. But I'm not your guy and I won't even pretend like I am.
I don't self-generate. I just buy leads at this point.
Yeah, I just do mail drops now.
The greatest gift you're going to have in the insurance industry is the ability to speak and understand the English language. And if you can be effective on the phone, you can be effective in the house, work on that skill. I'm the best guy on the phone that I know. If I self-generate my own appointments, the likelihood that I'll close that account is far better. So if you wanted to work a system similar to mine, the best telemarketer you can put on the phone is you. When David and I started, that's what we tried to train people how to do. I had people in my headset trying to listen to me to do that. And you guys don't want to pick up the phones. You know, I didn't get anybody to move forward with it. So, and when David pointed out how much money I make doing what I do, then I pay it out. I pay a Filipino telemarketer $200 a week. It costs me $800 a month to generate 12 to 16 appointments a week. And most of the time I give her the day off, because if I'm going back, I say, hey, you know, book me two. Or, you know, if I come up here, I say, you got the day. She gets a lot of paid vacations. I take care of her, because she is my income. I'm not abusive to her. I'm very generous with her. I sent her, Dave said, you know, bring your laptop with you. I said, I sent it to the Philippines. Her computer broke down when the pandemic hit. You know, I said, hey, you know, we're going to have to turn this thing off. And she said, you know, I got to feed my kids. And I kept her on until she got another job for a couple of months. And she's still with me. Relationships with people are very, very important. If you want to know, if you can get a relationship with your clients, great. If you can get a relationship with a person that helps you get those clients, even better. If you can get a relationship with a smart enough guy that shows you how to get all those things in place, even better. Long-term relationships is the key there. You know, focus your attention on where income-producing behavior is and put your attention there.
I'll speak on the self-generation front. Ideally, if you can economically create a business in the insurance business, it's better to buy leads than to market and then sell. Marketing is a skill set that takes time to develop. It's not easy. I don't know if it's necessarily simple either, but it's certainly not easy. And but learning that skill set is very, very valuable. It does scale over different platforms. You're not beholden to the one thing in your business that if it disappears or if the mailhouse goes up in flames, you know, you're not stuck. Because one is the loneliest number in business, okay? One of anything is your bottleneck, and that's always a problem. I personally, if you think about it in my business of recruiting now, I don't buy leads. I create organic traffic. I create the marketing that draws me in the leads. The quality of the leads are better, and arguably the lead flow is superior too. And I think that's paid me quite a bunch of dividends. So I think there's value in self-generation. It's not as easy, though, getting started. I used to say, and I've kind of softened up on this to an extent, that it's more of an intermediate goal, that if you want to look into Facebook marketing or some kind of self-generation strategy, that doing that after 6 to 12 months, after establishing yourself and having some consistency selling, is a good idea. But especially on the Facebook front, telesales to an extent, if you can control the marketing and you're comfortable with that, I'm open-minded to an agent who's starting off to do that. Because if you can cut out the middleman, you can dramatically cut your costs. Bobby V is the vendor we recommend that will teach you how to do Facebook marketing. Absolutely does a great job. And paying $5, $10 a lead is a lot better than some of the garbage you'll get from especially these Facebook lead vendors. So I think it can be right for some, but not for others. So you just kind of have to measure it out.